Welcome back. So today we're going to talk about operation strategy and how it affects our competitiveness in the workplace. But before we do that, let's really talk about what is the role of the operation strategy. What does it really give us? It actually provides a plan. It's a plan so that we can actually execute on a business strategy. A business strategy is more like the vision that we're looking at, but how then do we bring it to the organization and within an organization and encapsulate what we need to do? Now we need to make a distinction here. It's different than what people usually think of as like operations efficiency. So operations efficiency really is where we're trying to do things well. So we have a series of tasks and we want to make them cheaper, faster, everything that leads to efficiency. But that's not really what we're talking about when we talk about operations strategy. Operations strategy really helps us facilitate and embody a set of tasks and or functions that the company is going to do to enable our business strategy to be enacted. So we keep talking about the business strategy, so we really need to take a step back before we can dive into how do we create an operations strategy. So the first thing we need to do is look at the overall or the business strategy. And we talk about this in some other classes, so I'm not going to berate it too long here. But it's really our long-term planning. It's our long-term vision, and we usually break it apart into several components. So if we have a vision of what we want the company to be, that's usually encapsulated in a mission. We then have to break it down to the different functions. Now there's usually, in most organizations, a marketing function, an operations function, and a finance function. So we can break these down into three strategies that we make to help support and build the whole business strategy. Marketing is really how do we do support of marketing and sales that's going to support the business. Operations is how do we do things internally to convert and make product or some value added service for those types of systems. And then the finance strategy is how do we fund it all and keep that going. So it kind of goes in a little bit of a sequence, if you will. So we have our business strategy, what we're really trying to accomplish as a business. Again, this also applies for non-for-profits. It's our long-range plans. Now we bring it back in a little bit to develop our operation strategy of how are we going to do the day-to-day to build and support that business strategy. And these become our operational plans. And it also is based on something that we'll talk about a little bit more called competitive priorities. That then in turn allows us to design our operational functions, the real nuts and bolts of what our company does. So that's our structure, our facilities. How do we have flow of goods? We've got materials coming in, goods going out. If we're building product and or services, we've got resources and knowledge coming in and services going out. And those can be intertwined. Also the infrastructure. What does our planning look like? Do we have any control systems? How do we deal with our workers, pay, quality controls? All those types of features now get really down to nuts and bolts. So backing up to the overall business strategy, there's three critical factors in our business strategy that's going to then lead to our operational strategy. Again, what is our mission? What is our overall goal? Does the company understand the market? This is what we call environmental scanning. And we talk about this more in other classes, so we're just kind of highlighting it again. What are the company's strengths? What are our core competencies? And those core competencies are what we can build off of as we go. So what are some key factors in a business strategy? Well, let's look at an example of, say, Dell Computer. Their mission plan is to be the most successful computer company in the world. And so that's like their overarching mission. Okay, great. That's something they can get a lot of buy-in, a lot of stakeholders can believe in that. They also then have to look at the landscape, that their environment, the environment that they're working in. So they have political trends, what are the social trends, what are economic trends? You got to pay attention to those because you don't want to be building something that's going in the wrong direction. Market trends, globally, what's going on. And then again, their core competencies. For them, it's the strength of their workers, their modern facilities, their understanding of the market, because they've been playing at it for a while now. What are the best technologies they can leverage, their financial abilities, and their logistical capacity. So that's a little bit different than we talk about core competencies. So this is an example for general technology company. So what are some of the things? If we're talking about facilities, it's, well, how good is our supply chain? How efficiently can we distribute things? How fast and well can we produce things? What's level of automation that we may or may not have? in our facilities. All those things can affect our competency in the facilities themselves. Our financial know-how, what's our skill at attracting and raising capital or disseminating that capital effectively, or investing and growing capital that we've got coming in. Market understanding, how well do we know what the customer wants and what are the trends? What about our technology, the intellectual property there? Are we at the state-of-the-art level? Are we implementing the state-of-the-art because it's just come online? Are we making use of the latest trends, such as like AI and machine learning, which are hot topics now? Is that going to be leverageable for us? What about our quality controls? We don't want to have a product going out the door that hasn't had quality checks on it, because then we'll have to have lots of recalls. Our workforce expertise, do they have to be highly trained? If so, do we have that as a competency? Are we having to hire contractors? How flexible are we? Do we have strong technical capabilities? What about our creative design flow for the next phase of products? So all these things may or may not be core competencies for your tech organization. So this could either be in a startup world, this could be in an existing company. But it's really important to understand what those core competencies are. It's also important not to say that you're competent in something that you're really not, because sometimes people can believe that their company is really competent in something, and when you look at around the landscape, they're not as competent as they think. Okay, so operations can compete on four things. There's cost, quality, time, and flexibility. So cost is really what it sounds like. Can we offer a product or good or service at a lower price than the competition? That's one direction you can go. You can also compete on quality. Maybe our performance is better than our competition's, or maybe our service is much more consistent. It's very reliable compared to some other group. How about time? Maybe we're rapid on-time delivery, and that's something that Amazon really tries to do, right? Or we have a turnaround, rapid turnaround or repair. So if something goes wrong, they'll take care of you. Those are things that can matter a lot to consumers in certain technology spaces. And our flexibility. What's our product flexibility, our volume flexibility? Can you order a custom version of what you would like? Maybe you can, maybe you can't. What is the focus? So you can compete on any one of these, and oftentimes for startups, you may want to tailor toward one and then work on another one later. And there are some companies that try to do, you know, all of them, but it's typically hard to do all of them the best all the time, because you have all the other competitors that are trying to do the same thing. So there's a need oftentimes for trade-offs in these types of decisions. So you want to emphasize what are the priorities that support the business strategy the best, because we always have to keep an eye back on that. Which trade-off are we willing to make, which may mean we want to compete on one of those items and not all of them. And then we got to focus on what are our qualifiers and what are our winners. So our order qualifiers, this is where we can meet the competitive priorities, particularly in a place where the market expects that we meet, you know, some minimum priority in there. We want to make sure that we do that, because if we don't, we're not going to be competitive and we're not going to sell product or services. And which priorities are the order winners? So is it cost that's really going to beat out the competition? Is it our consistency? Is it our speed? What types of things is it going to be? So here's just kind of a hint here of different companies. So Dell, they try to say they compete on all four. That's debatable. Southwest Airlines, they definitely compete upon cost as far as the airline prices. McDonald's, they probably do cost and consistency. FedEx or Amazon, they're all about speed as far as getting things to you. And then maybe something more customizable or flexible. So maybe your local pizza place, like Barrow's is a pizza place out here, and it has a homemade taste. So it's always a quality, good item. So we then have to translate these priorities into some production requirements. And remember, we classified these as two things. There's the structure decisions that we have to make, which affects our production process. And then there's the infrastructure decisions that we have to make. This really relates to our control system and our operations and how do we run things. So looking at the structural decisions, it affects the types of facilities that we need, so the characteristics of those facilities. Maybe we need a wet lab, or maybe we need a clean room, or maybe just office space. It depends on what we're trying to do. Select our appropriate technology or technologies that are going to be required to do the operation. And what is the flow of goods and services? This gets much more into supply chain and distribution. The infrastructure is, how do we organize our operations? Do we go functional? Do we go based on contracts? And maybe we have more of a service style organization. What's the skill and pay of the workers that we're going to require? What is the quality control approaches that we're going to have in place to make sure that we're competing to a high level? So all of those are important to us. So another example, we've been using Dell Computer for several examples. They do a lot of focus on customer service, cost, and speed. That's why they're still out there. They're one of the premier computer makers. They've survived where many computer makers have left the game. There's still HP. There's still, you know, Apple, and now Microsoft also with their Surface Pros. So there's a few competitors left, but Dell is still one of those early competitors that has been in the game for a long time and is still doing pretty well. What type of resource management system do they allow? Now we call it ERP. We're going to talk about those near the end of the course. But suffice it to say, it's a semi-automated to automated system that allows customers to order directly, which is pretty impressive because you can actually customize your order right online. I've done it myself. It's actually quite impressive. It's like ordering a car that you just want to have certain paint jobs and things like that, but you can customize what do you want inside of your computer. Product design and assembly allows you to make your order strategy. You can decide, do I want to include something, not include something? And then you want to ship the components to a warehouse within 15 minutes of the assembly plant. So they've really set those things up. And then they have an arrangement for shipping already set up with discounted shipping through a partner like UPS. So they've really tried to target several things that help along that entire process. Okay, because we're also, again, talking about technology companies in general, we kind of want to touch on what are some of the strategic roles of technology. It, again, must be supportive of our competitive priorities. There's three types of technology applications that we want to consider. There's product technology, number one. This is usually where we're trying to look at implementing any new technology that may help us, give us competitive advantage, or revolutionize the type of products we're sticking out there. Some examples are things like Teflon, which was a non-stick coating for some things, or you can make it into other types of products. Fiber optic cables, you know, CDs were transformative before or after tapes, but then digital memory started taking over after that. Process technology. This is technology that's applied to the process of how you transform inputs into outputs, you know, raw materials into cell phones or whatever that is. Maybe this is like flexible automation, could be computer automated drafting or design. CAMs, where we can actually produce things in three dimensions. 3D printing is another process technology. And then, of course, information technology. This is enabling communication and transfer of data. So this is a little bit different than, it is part of process, I would argue. However, it's also transferring information not just internally, it also can be between customer and the company and or suppliers in the company. So there's several different examples of that. So really what we're trying to do is use technology as a tool for us to gain and or keep a competitive advantage. But there is some strategic decisions when you do these types of things. So the benefits of leveraging technology, you can improve your process oftentimes, maintain up-to-date standards, and again, try to gain and or keep your competitive advantages. The risks, however, that you could choose the wrong technology or back the wrong horse, that can be very costly. You can overstate the benefits. Sometimes it can be way too much. So, for example, with Tesla. They tried to over-automate in the beginning and it really bit them for a while. There were some things that they decided that automation is not the best policy, that they actually needed the human touch. And obsolescence. You know, you can spend tons of money on some of these automations or what have you, and then they could be obsolete in just a few years. All right, so then with all these things that we're talking about, operation strategy, how do we have metrics to see what that does for us? And we talked also about operational efficiency. So in operational efficiency, and with this, what we're trying to look at is what are some metrics that we can use to see how well we're doing? Did we make some good decisions? Did it help us? How do we know? And one of the real bare bones baseline measures is called productivity. You've probably heard it in the news all the time. You hear it all the time. It's not a fixed definition. There's actually several ways you can tackle productivity. And I want to make sure that's clear because depending upon the type of productivity we ask for, the equation is slightly different. So in general, so general productivity is a measure of how efficient our output is versus our input. So really we're looking at output versus input. Now, we almost never ask for just that because that's too generalized. You're like, output of what? Input of what? So we try to get a little bit more granular with that. So something like total productivity is a more specific measure. So total productivity is the output produced divided by all the inputs used. Now, to do this, you may need to have different units depending upon what we're looking at. And that's where we get to something like partial productivity. So partial productivity is not all of the output over all of the input. It's really the output measured versus some inputs that we have a measurement on, because you may not have an accurate measure of all the outputs. So, for example, partial productivity could be output divided by labor. So in other words, how much output or product are we getting, number of widgets, let's say. Let's say we get 100 widgets per, 3 hours of labor or whatever that is. That is a partial productivity measure. So we can do it per labor, or that's not the only way to do partial productivity. We could put some different input in there. But again, usually the output is measured the same. It's usually either number of units, which is a very common way to measure productivity. It could be the value of those units. So it could be the number of the units times a monetary multiplier. That could be there too. So in partial productivity, output over capital, just to get it to be unitless, since we're talking about amount of money that we invest into a system, how much money do we get out of it? And then we get a fraction that's unitless. That's another way you can do partial productivity. There's also multi-factor productivity. So again, we may not know all of the inputs, or we can't measure all of the inputs or the outputs, but we might be able to have a better understanding of certain ones that we can measure. So an example could be any of these following. So a multi-factor productivity means we have multiple inputs versus that output. So here we've got output divided by, maybe we know our labor numbers and we know the amount we've put in materials. And maybe we put all these in cost terms. We could put all of these in monetary terms. Or it could be the output generated divided by our labor plus the machines we've invested in, if we're talking about automation instead of manual labor. Or again, we could have three categories. We could have labor, materials, and capital that gets divided into the output. So depending upon the information that you have or the information you have access to, that will determine what type of multi-factor productivity that you can calculate. So be careful on that, particularly when you have like homework problems or things. We'll usually specify the type of productivity that we're talking about. It could be total productivity if we had all that information, but more likely not. Partial productivity is definitely something you'll see a lot, and multi-factor productivity depending upon what types of input information you have. So keep an understanding of that. So here's an example. We have Long Beach Bank employs 3 loan officers. Each works 8 hours a day. Each officer processes an average of 5 loans a day. Okay, so that's how many loans that they do in a day. And each one, it works 8 hours a day. The bank payroll costs the officers is $820 per day. There's daily overhead expense of $500. Again, overhead is for the offices, the air conditioning, the lights, all those kinds of things. The bank has just purchased a new computer software, should enable each loan officer to process 8 loans a day instead of 5. Although the overhead will increase to $550, let's evaluate that change and see if it makes sense. Now, the way they want to evaluate is based upon labor and multi-factor productivity before and after implementation. Now, here, the other factor is the cost of the software. That's going to be a cost on the input, and we can treat it as a capital item or just software cost. So before we begin this, make sure we know what the value of our inputs and our outputs are. So when you look at this, the outputs are the number of loans. The inputs are going to be the cost, right? So here they're measuring the input in terms of dollars. And so it's going to be the labor costs plus the software costs. For the after scenario, it's just going to be the labor costs before. And then we'll do a measure, hopefully head to head. So if we look at the old way, we had 3 officers doing 5 loans per day each. And so we're generating 15 loans per day. Now notice it doesn't say anything about the quality of those loans. So that's a little bit beyond the scope of this problem. But let's just assume that all the loans are equal in this case. And this is out of 24 labor hours. So if we're looking purely at labor productivity, we're looking at what we're getting out of each day. And each day there's 24 labor hours. Now, you could make that argument. It's like, well, that's not really quite accurate because you may not have loan officers working the night shift, or you're only working one shift, so maybe it's only 8 labor hours. That can be argued. But as long as if you're comparing old to new, you keep those labor hours consistent. So if they're going to say 24 labor hours in this example, fine. But as long as you're doing the same thing on the denominator for the old and the same on the new, then you'll still get effective results. So if you look at labor productivity for new, 3 officers, 8 loans a day, 24 hours, you get 24 loans in 24 hours. That's pretty much 1 loan per hour versus the before was 0.625 loans per hour. Now that sounds great. You know, just from labor productivity alone, that makes it sound like, okay, that's a no-brainer. We should buy the software. Well, hold the phone. Let's actually do a multifactorial analysis and see what we get from a total cost standpoint. So multi-factor productivity old, 15 loans a day, because remember it was 3 officers times 5 loans. We had $820 a day plus the overhead, which was the $500 a day. So if we do that, we get 0.0113 loans per dollar. If we look at the new one where we're getting 24 loans in a day, and it's $820 and plus $550, so now we've added that extra $50, how much productivity are we actually gaining? Well, it's not really the 15 to 24 that much of a gain. It's really just 0.0175 loans per dollar versus 0.0113 loans per dollar. Now, that being said, it is an increase. So if we look at the difference in the increase, it's really going to be the 0.0175 divided by the 0.0113 loans per dollar, which goes in 1.55 times, but the increase is what's beyond one. So it's 1.55 minus 1, and then you get a 55% increase. So that's actually pretty good. So you notice if you put it in dollars, the increase doesn't look as large as the 60% increase that they showed here of 1 divided by 0.625, which looked like a 60% increase. However, it did show a significant increase. So in this example, you would probably make the decision to make the software purchase because it's still going to give you an increase pretty substantially. All right. So that's kind of a way that you can look at productivity of making a decision to do something new versus where you were. How do we interpret productivity measures? Well, it kind of depends. We usually have to compare it to something. Like in the last example, we saw a comparison of the old way of doing things versus the new way of doing things. And so that's important to us. It must be compared to something, either a previous year or comparing how we do things to another company, something like that. Otherwise, it's just a number, right? So the first time you do it, you may not have anything. But if you're going to make decisions, you got to be able to compare it to something. So raw productivity calculations don't tell us a complete story unless there is no major structural differences. So that's kind of important for us. So other types of things is, are we looking at the partial productivity measurement? Can it help us make an investment decision? That was like the example that we just saw. Should we invest in the software or should we not invest in the software? Yeah, we know we might get a little bit more gains, but how does that help us compared to the cost of the software? Is the total cost of productivity measure a better reflection of year-to-year productivity at 4.2% and 1.6% or not? Should you also look at different productivity measures for major two competitors for comparison? There's lots of different ways we can look at those types of things. So it really depends upon the story you're trying to tell or the information you're trying to interrogate to get to an answer to make decisions. So the productivity measure provides information on how we're doing relative to what's critical. So that's usually where you want to be asking the questions. Is it critical for us, like say in the bank, to get more loans per person? If it is, then that's the type of measure we want to look at. If we're trying to make more widgets per employee on the manufacturing line, that would be a productivity measure that would be critical for a lot of things where they're trying to boost production, all those types of things. So anytime we're talking about productivity, we're really trying to measure effective resource use. And it goes hand in hand with things. So are we doing things better or not? And productivity has been in the news a lot where it tries to directly relate productivity and standard of living. But let's examine this a little bit more. So we have U.S. productivity has grown on an average of 2.8% from 1948 through 1973. But then after 1973, it's slowed down for the next 25 years to an average of 1.1%. And then now we're seeing less in manufacturing, but more in service industries, that productivity growth has been growing, but not as much. So what does that mean to us? That means we're building more goods, but how does that translate to something that is useful to us? So here's like in the business sector, they show productivity output per hour. So the annual percentage change, if you notice from this Bureau of Labor Statistics from 95 all the way through 2014, has shown a positive productivity or output per hour. It was from a low end of just below about 0.75 or 0.8%, all the way to a high of where it was near 5% in 2003-2004. And there's probably a lot that had to be due with the technology developments and the internet and things like that that have developed this. But in general, our productivity has risen over time. What does that mean to the average United States citizen? Well, growth of productivity versus compensation, because most of us work for companies if we don't own them. And how does this work out? Well, if we say net productivity, the net productivity has really shot up 72%. Now, does that correlate or is there a direct relationship between that productivity and compensation? Well, if we look at the real average hourly compensation, it's in the medium color blue here, we see about a 42.5% rise in average. Now remember, averages are heavily affected by outliers. So an average also includes usually executives or people that have much higher end salaries versus the average worker. So those averages are a little bit deceiving because they really don't show where most people are at. A better measure is the median, because remember, the median is where 50% of people, say, in a company are making higher than that, 50% are making lower. That's a better measure of what's really going on. And if you notice there, it's only 8.7% since, probably early 70s all the way through 2014. So 8.7% sounds like a lot until you take in effect of inflation. And if inflation is growing at roughly, 1.5-2% a year, well, in reality, hourly compensation has actually gone down when you're not compensating for inflation. So that's where you're seeing a big discrepancy between the haves and have-nots, between owners and or CEOs and what's happening to a lot of the workforce. So although a net productivity does make you more competitive in the workforce, and it does do a lot for keeping companies competitive, there's not necessarily a direct correlation with compensation. Even though there is a little bit of a rising trend, and it's probably necessary, it's not the only factor. So really, your standard of living does not equal the same thing as your quality of life. So, because think about it. Yes, you may be more productive, but maybe being more productive means you're working more hours or you have less breaks, or there's could be all sorts of things. So if standard of living, and I like this saying from Zig Ziglar, so standard of living is your major objective, quality of life almost never improves. So maybe instead of using standard of living as a major objective, quality of life should probably be the objective that we seek. All right. Thank you, and have a wonderful time. I will see you in class.